Okay, so hello everyone. My name is Valentin and I'm a .NET developer. And today I would like to tell you about the garbage collector pressure. I think for those of you who have not yet encountered such an effect, it will be useful to learn about it and how to minimize it, thereby increasing performance on your own applications. And for those who have already encountered, I hope today's presentation will be a good opportunity to refresh your knowledge. So let's move on. I divided my presentation into several parts. First, I will give you a brief overview of the garbage collection process, the garbage collection pressure, and then we will look at a few of the most common techniques to minimize the impact of such pressure on the performance. My presentation will take about 30 minutes. If you have any questions, feel free to ask. So, as garbage collector manages all the allocation and release of memory of your application. Each time you create a new object, the CLR allocates memory for the object from the managed heap. If the address space is available in the managed heap, the runtime continues to allocate space for new objects. However, memory is not infinite. Eventually, the garbage collector must perform a collection in order to free some memory. When the garbage collector performs a collection, it checks for objects in the managed heap that are no longer being used by the application and performs the necessary operations to reclaim their memory. In large applications, the number of objects that the garbage collector needs to deal with can become very large, which means it can take a very long time to visit and rearrange all of them. To deal with this, NET uses a generational garbage collector, which tries to give priority to a smaller set of objects. The idea is that objects created recently are more likely to be realized quickly. So a generational garbage collector prioritizes them when trying to free up memory. So NET first looks at the objects that have been allocated since the last garbage collection and only starts to consider older objects if it can't free up enough space in this way. There are three generations of objects on the heap, as you can see on my screen. Generation 0 is the youngest generation and contains short-lived objects like temporary variables or something like that. Garbage collector occurs most frequently in this generation. Newly allocated objects form a new generation of objects and are implicitly generation 0 collections. However, if they are large objects, they go on the large object heap in a generation 2 collection. Most objects are reclaimed for garbage collection in generation 0 and do not survive to the next generations. Generation 1 contains short-lived objects and serves as a buffer between short-lived objects and long-lived objects. Generation 2 contains long-lived objects like an object in the server application that contains static data that live for the duration of the process. Objects that survive a generation 0 garbage collections are promoted to generation 1. Objects that survive a generation 1 garbage collections are promoted to generation 2. Objects that survive a generation 2 garbage collection remain in generation 2. When the garbage collector detects that the survival rate is high in a generation, it increases the threshold of allocations of the generation. Collecting a generation means collecting objects in the generation and all its younger generations, as you can see at the slide. A generation 2 garbage collection is also known as a full garbage collection because it reclaims all objects in all generations, that is, all objects in the managed heap. Garbage collector pressure occurs when the garbage collector does not keep up with memory deallocations. So when you are creating new objects and disposing of them too quickly for the garbage collector to keep up. When the garbage collector is pressured, it will spend more time garbage collecting and these collections will come more frequently. When your application spends more time garbage collecting, it spends less time executing your code, thus directly hurting performance. Now, let's discuss the possible ways to minimize the garbage collector pressure. And first, let's look at the tool that we will use to measure performance in this presentation. One moment. Okay. As a tool for measuring performance, I used the benchmark.net NuGet package. Sorry. It's free and easy to use and allows you to quickly get the required performance measurements of individual methods. The package was used for the following configuration. As you can see, I use the latest version of benchmark.net and the latest version of Windows 10. Also, I used Intel Core i7 CPU and the latest version of .NET Core SDK. Also, the following temporary values were used as the results of the benchmark.net package. As you can see, the main value of the results is mean. It's arithmetic means of all measurements. And also, I want to mention that the measurements were performed in nanoseconds. So, also, I want to mention that the results output is quite flexible for benchmark.net package. However, I used this default configuration because it is enough to demonstrate the results of the tests in our presentation today. So, the first technique relates to dynamic collections. .NET provides a lot of collection types like list or dictionary. All those collections have dynamic size capacity. That means they are automatically expand in size as you add more items. Whenever the collection reaches its size limit, it will allocate a new large memory buffer, usually in array double in size. That means an additional allocation and deallocation. And now let's look at the following example. Here we have a method dealing with list collection with default capacity and expanded in size. And in the second method, I set the initial capacity for the number of items is going to have its list size. And for 1,000 items, the results were the following, as you can see in the table. You can see that the list with fixed capacity was faster than list with dynamic capacity. So by setting capacity, we saved almost 30% in performance time. In practice, the improvement of performance is probably even greater because benchmark.net performs garbage collections before and after each benchmark run. Also, I performed another benchmark for dictionary collection, and here you can see the dynamic size of dictionary and method with the fixed size of dictionary. And the results were the following. So as you can see, setting the initial size for dynamic collections can be very useful. Let's move on. And the second technique relates to arrays. The allocation of arrays can be quite costly. Performing this allocation in high frequency will cause garbage collector pressure and hurt performance. As a solution, we can use the ArrayPool class found in System Buffer's NuGet package. The idea is the shared buffer for arrays is allocated, which you can reuse without allocating and deallocating memory. So let's take a look at the following example. In the first method, we initialize a regular array. In the second method, we are using the ArrayPool. And we are trying to measure the performance for the 100 items first, and the results were the following. And we are going to run this benchmark for 1,000 items, and the results were the following. So as you can see, the array pool allocation time stays the same, whereas regular allocation time increases as the size grows. So like in thread pool with threads, array pool could be useful for short-term large arrays. And let's move on. The third technique relates to a class and structures. Structs have several benefits when it comes to deallocation. When structs are not part of a class, they are allocation on stack and don't require garbage collection at all. Also, structs are stored on heap when they are part of a class or any reference time. In that case, they are stored inline and deallocated when the containing type is deallocated. Inline means the struct data is stored as is, as opposite to a reference type, where a pointer is stored to another location on the heap with the actual data. This is exactly meaningful in collections, where a collection of struct is much cheaper to deallocate because it's just one buffer of memory. And also structs takes less memory than a reference type because they don't have an object header and method table. And let's look at the following example. We have the following class and structure of vectors, as you can see on the slide. And also we have two methods. In the first method, we create an array of classes. And in the second method, we create an array of structures. So let's measure the performance. For 1,000 items, the results were the following. So as you can see, the structure is quite faster than classes. And the allocation is faster than class allocations. What conclusion we can do here? We can actually use structs for the following is true. The struct size is less than or equal of 16 bytes. The structs are short-lived. The struct is immutable. And the structs will not have be boxed frequently. The next technique, relates to finalizers. Finalizers in C# are very expensive for several reasons. Any class with a finalizer is automatically promoted to a generation by the garbage collector. This means they can be garbage collected in generation 0, which is the fastest generation. The finalizer is placed in the finalizer queue, handled by a single dedicated thread. This can cause problems if some finalizers run for a long time or throws an exception. And let's take a look at the example. Here we have the following classes and two instances of these classes. One of the class with a finalizer and the second one is without it. And here we have a method in which we use a class without a finalizer. And in the second method, we use a class with a finalizer. For 100,000 items, the results of measuring performance was the following. As you can see, the results are in favor of classes without finalizers. So try to avoid finalizers, and if they are really necessary, for example, when you're using a dispose pattern, you should suppress the finalizer and save the performance. The next technique concerns working with short-lived arrays. When using arrays with a short life cycle, garbage collection can be avoided at all. The stack alloc keyword in C# allows for very fast allocation and deallocation of unmanaged memory. It's used for primitives, structs, and arrays. The stack alloc operator allocates the block of memory on the stack. A stack allocated memory block created during the method execution is automatically discarded when the method returns. You cannot explicitly free memory allocated with the stack alloc operator. A stack allocated memory block is not subject of the garbage collection. So let's see the example. Here we have a method when we create an instance of the class through the operator new. And in the second method, we use a stack alloc keyword. And let's try to measure performance for 5 items in this cycle, and the results will be the next. As we can see, stack alloc is twice faster than using the new operator. And if we try to measure performance for 100 items, the results will be the next. So as we can see, the stack alloc is useful to use to avoid garbage collector pressure and increase the performance of your application. So for arrays with a short life cycle, you can use stack alloc to first allocate and release from memory. The sixth technique is related to strings. As you probably know, when you concatenate in strings, a new string object is allocated. populated with content, and eventually garbage collected. To prevent this new allocation and improve performance, the string builder class was created. But not all things so good with strings. Let's take a look at the some example of concatenation. So here we have a regular concatenation. We have a concatenation using the string builder class. We have the concatenation using string format method. And here we have the simple interpolation. And the result of performance measuring was the following. As we can see in this case, string builder does not offer any advantages against a single expression concatenation with a small number of strings. But let's look at example of concatenating multiple expressions. In the first method, we concatenated with 1000 repetitions, and also we have a private static string builder variable. In the second method, we use the creation of new string builder object. And in the third method, we use the already created string builder object. So let's try to measure a performance for 1000 items. And the result will be the next. So as we can see here, for multi-expression string builder, it's quite good. And even if you use an already created string builder instance, is even faster. So what conclusion we can get from here? Regular concatenations are more efficient than string builder for a small number of concatenation. Depending on string size, using string builder becomes more efficient with over 10 or 15 concatenations. String builder can be optimized by setting its initial capacity, and string builder can be optimized by reusing the same instance. This can make a difference for very frequent usages like logging. And the next technique is related to memory leaks. Memory leaks are a constant troublemaker in any big application. With a memory leak, objects remain referenced even when they are officially unused. While referenced, the garbage collector will keep promoting them to a higher generation instead of collecting them. These promotions are expensive and add work for the garbage collector. Memory leaks cause more memory to be in use. This means you will run out of free space quicker, causing the garbage collector to do more frequent collections. Since memory leaks are a very extensive and specific topic, in this presentation we will not dwell on specific examples that can be great, many related to, for example, events, static variables, caching functionality, binding, etc., etc. I will only indicate some best practices for avoiding memory leaks. So, first one is detect a memory leak problem with special tools. You can use here diagnostic tool window, and it could be quite useful. You can easily indicate the garbage collector is trying to free memory, but it keeps rising. Next easiest way to detect major memory leak problem is with the task manager or process explorer. These tools can show the amount of memory your process uses. If it's consistently increased over time, you probably have a memory leak. Perf monitor is a bit harder to use, but can show a nice graph of your memory usage over time. And a memory profiler is the main tool to find and fix memory leak. You can easily attach to a running process and create a snapshot. The quickest and most useful profiling technique is to compare two snapshots where the memory should return to the same state. The first snapshot is taken before an operation and another snapshot is taken after the operation. The second best practice is use dispose pattern to prevent and manage memory leaks. The point of this pattern is to allow explicit disposal of resources, but also to add a safeguard that your resources will be disposed during garbage collector in the finalizer if the dispose was not called. But don't forget to suppress the finalizer. It makes sure the finalizer is not called on garbage collection if the object was already disposed. Objects with finalizers are freed differently and much more costly. Also, you can use the uses word in C# for this purposes. The next best practice is add memory telemetry or memory logging from code. It would be useful to use Microsoft Diagnostic Runtime Library or Performance Counter to log your memory in your application. And the next one good practice is test for memory leaks. It's a great practice to proactively test for memory leaks, and it's not that hard. There's a short button you can use, you can see on the screen. So, as we can see, avoiding memory leaks will have a positive effect on performance and help avoid garbage collection pressure. So now we looked at a few of the most common techniques to minimize the impact of garbage collector pressure on the performance. Summarizing the above, you probably noticed that all of the above optimization make use of more of the following core concepts. First one is allocation should be avoided if it's possible. Reusing memory is better than allocating new memory. Allocating on stack is faster than allocating on the heap. These are not only concepts in performance optimizations, but probably the most important ones when it comes to garbage collector pressure. I assume this is all that I wanted to show you today, and now I'll be happy to answer your questions if you have any.
First of all, hello.
Hello.
It was very good material. Thank you.
Thank you.
So the question from my side is whether we can get some video from this. I see it's recording.
Yes, we can get the video from this after the presentation on the community blog. And also I will upload the code with the benchmark. So you can not only see the video and use my code from this presentation to inspect it or what you want to do with it.
Okay, I just want to watch it.
Okay.
All right. Thank you. Thank you very much for this. That was good.
Mm-hmm, thank you.
I have one more question. Saying about memory leaks, saying about .NET, probably it's more common to use resource leak like terminology in this case, because memory leaks like is more related to not manageable applications and platforms. No.
Actually, you got a point. Yes, you could use the technique you mentioned, but also I think the memory leaks is could be a huge problem in case of garbage collector pressure.
Yeah, you are right.
But for unmanaged resources.
Right.
So, and one more thing about the unmanaged resources, you can easily use the methods from garbage collector, add memory pressure and release memory pressure in case if you need to allocate the unmanaged memory.
Yep.
Thank you for question. Any other questions?
Actually, I would add some points. So you actually can use unsafe code. So it may cause memory leak, as I remember. That's the previous question.
Yes. Any other questions?
Yes, I have a question. As you demoed, you recommend to use String Builder instead of String. Why does Microsoft or everybody use String and instead of String Builder? String and use String Builder everywhere.
I can say that String Builder is useful for a big concatenations or a big arrays of strings. Maybe Microsoft using String because in case of using not so large amount of strings in it. So if you have, for example, I don't know, a lot of telemetry values from spacecraft, I think you will use String Builder because it can concatenating faster such huge amount of data. So I think the String Builder is quite useful for especially big amounts of data, but not for a small, as I mentioned in my presentation.
What about the immutability of the string itself? Mm-hmm. What do you think? But that also, do you think the string immutability has the advantage over the string builder in the terms of the usage, not the construction itself?
Mm-hmm. I think the just string would be faster than string builder in some, as I mentioned earlier, small amounts of data, and it would be really faster because the string builder, a huge class with huge methods, memories, etc., etc. So if you have small amounts of data to deal with string data, please use string. If you have a large amount of data, you can try use string builder, but be sure that it would be faster for you.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Any other questions?
Hi, I have a question. Mm-hmm. Do you have a real world example or maybe experience to use SPAN? Because in internet, a lot of examples how to use it like basics, but in the real world, in a business logic.
I can say that in the business logic of, for example, programming, I don't have much experience with that. I have only experience. I had the opportunity to work on our space industry, and there we are using spans for a big amounts of data, as I mentioned on my presentation. So it's really useful thing, but I think now I can't tell any more about this technique, much more than you can find in internet.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Any other questions? So if you have not any more questions, thank you very much for your attention. I hope this presentation was useful for you.
One question regarding this meeting.